Welcome to Universal Light Christian Center, the City of Light. Our founder and lead pastor is Reverend Gail Talbert Smith. ULCC is a radiant, multi-generational gathering of believers who are dedicated, demonstrative, and determined to spread light, love, and hope throughout the world. There's always something exciting happening at ULCC.
ULCC, it is time for our third quarter consecration. It is time for 10 nights of fasting and prayer. Join us nightly on the prayer line at 6 p.m. September 14th through the 23rd as we come together and intercede for our nation, for our church, for our very lives. It is time for us to come together in prayer nightly, 6 o'clock p.m., September 14th through the 23rd, we will be on the prayer line. Does anybody want to pray with me?
Our Be the Light after school tutorial program will resume this fall on Zoom. Our Mercer University tutors are ready and will meet our students on Zoom. This is not the time for our students to fall behind. Let's keep them focused, let's keep them motivated, and let's keep them successful. Join the Be the Light After School Tutorial Program this fall on Zoom. For more information, contact Deacon Angela Atkins or email us at info@ulccmacon.org. ULCC seniors, Pastor would love to meet you on the prayer line every Wednesday from 12 to 12:30. This is a time to check in, spend time with Pastor in prayer and fellowship. Every Wednesday from 12 to 12:30 p.m., we are inviting our seniors. We love to call them the Incredibles of ULCC. Join Pastor on the prayer line for a time of fellowship and prayer this Wednesday from 12 to 12:30 p.m. We encourage you to participate in the following prayer opportunities throughout the week at ULCC. We're celebrating some special people with special days in the month of September. We salute the Christ in you and thank you for being the light of the world. We wish you happy birthday and a happy wedding anniversary from Universal Light Christian Center, the City of Light.
Good morning and welcome to Universal Light Christian Center. Right now we're going to open up our service with a prayer of praise and thanksgiving. Lord, we thank you for this day because this is the day that you have made and we will rejoice and be glad in it. Lord, we ask as we open our hearts and make room for you that you will speak to us through the songs, the word, and the scripture. Lord, we ask that you bless us through our giving and through our worship. Lord, and at the end of all of this, we will declare that we will never be the same again because you have been with us. And we thank you right now in Jesus' name, and so it is. Right now, we're going to move into our exhortation. It is our time of call and response, where we declare the greatness of our God. And you respond with, "For his mercy endureth forever." Oh, give thanks unto the Lord, for he is good. Oh, give thanks unto the God of gods. Oh, give thanks unto the Lord of lords, to him who alone doeth great wonders, to him who stretched out the earth above the waters, the sun to rule by day, the moon and the stars to rule by night, who remembered us in our low estate and hath redeemed us from every one of our enemies, who giveth food to all flesh. Oh, give thanks to the God of heaven, for his mercy endureth forever. Right now, we're going to go into our procession of flags.
Thank you. Hallelujah. Come on, right there at your house. Go ahead, put your hands together. Stomp your feet if you want to. Go ahead and get up and dance around your house, because we're going to give God some serious praise this morning, because he is our everything. Sing, God is my everything. Sing, God is my everything. Oh, he's my joy.
He's my joy in sorrow.
Yeah, he's my hope.
He's my hope
for tomorrow. Oh, he's my rock.
He's my rock
in a weary land.
Shelter
in the time of storm. Oh, God is,
God is,
God is my everything. Sing, God is, hallelujah. Sing, God is,
my everything.
Come on, just praise him. He's my joy.
For tomorrow.
Yeah, he's my rock.
He's my rock
in a weary
land.
My shelter in the time of a storm. Oh,
God is,
God is my everything. Come on, come on, come on, come on. You feel it now. Sing, God is my everything. Sing, God is my everything. Yeah,
he's my joy.
Yes, he's my hope.
He's my hope for tomorrow.
Yeah, he's my rock.
He's my rock
in a weary land.
Shelter
in the time of a storm. Yeah, God is,
God is,
God is.
Morning. I'll be reading Psalm 16, God's Word Translation. A Miktabi David. Protect me, O God, because I take refuge in you. I said to the Lord, you are my Lord. Without you, I have nothing good. those who lead holy lives on earth are noble ones who fill me with joy. Those who quickly chase after other gods multiply their sorrows. I will not pour out their sacrificial offerings of blood or use my lips to speak their names. The Lord is my inheritance and my cup. You are the ones who determine my destiny. Your boundary line marked out pleasant places for me. Indeed, my inheritance is something beautiful. I will praise the Lord who advised me. My conscience warns me at night. I would always keep the Lord in front of me. When he is by my side, I cannot be moved. That is why my heart is glad and my soul rejoices. My body rests securely because you do not abandon my soul to the grave or allow your holy ones to decay. You make the path of life known to me. Complete is the joy in your presence. Pleasures are by your side forever.
It's prayer time.
Whatever you need.
Yeah.
Whatever you need.
Father, we praise you and we thank you for your presence right now. We bless you, God, and declare this is the day the Lord has made. And we will rejoice and be glad in it. We thank you for your presence now in our lives and in our circumstances. We thank you for your presence in this time of prayer. We thank you, God, that you are right here with us, that you are in the room with us. We bless you now for your presence. And we thank you, God, that you're in the midst of us, in every home, in every room. So, God, it doesn't matter that we're not seated in the sanctuary. Because you are in the bedroom, you are in the living room, you are in the great room, you are in the kitchen, you are in every room, God, right where we are. And we thank you that you fill our houses and you fill our dwelling places with your presence. And God, we decree right now that there is healing in the room, that there is peace in the room, there is love in the room, there is power in the room, there is strength in the room, there is provision in the room, there is protection in the room. Everything we need, God, is right here in the room with us, and we glorify you for it now. Thank you for your presence, God. Thank you for caring about us, God. Thank you for the promise that you'll never leave us nor forsake us. And though we pass through different kinds of circumstances, you said I'll be with you always. So it doesn't matter whether we're in COVID or out of COVID. It doesn't matter whether we're in debt or out of debt. It doesn't matter, God, whether we're employed or unemployed. It doesn't matter what the situation, because whatever we need is right here. I hear your word saying, and my God will supply all your need according to his riches and glory. in Christ Jesus. So, Father, we thank you for it now. We decree, God, that yours is the kingdom. So we recognize your sovereign control of our homes and of our lives, and yours is the power. So we recognize your ability to be there and to accomplish all that we need, and yours is the glory. So we give you credit for everything you're doing right now. In the name of Jesus, the living Christ. Amen. And so it is. It's right here, God. And we thank you. It's in the room. And so it is. Thank you, God.
Praise God. Praise God from whom all blessings flow. Just want to thank God right now because we serve an awesome God. We serve a mighty God. We serve a God that is above any financial difficulties that we may be having right now. So we thank God because he continues to provide. He continues to care about each and every one of us. He knows our needs. He knows our desires. And we thank God right now that those needs are being met. So we thank him right now. And we're coming out of this. We're coming out of these financial difficulties. We're coming out of this pandemic, and we will not smell like smoke. So I thank God right now for what he is doing in the atmosphere, what he's doing for ULCC and all those that are listening, and that he's providing and he's making a way, and he continues to open doors for us. This is our time right now. It is our time of giving, and we praise God in spite of everything that is going around us. We still give thanks to him for what he's doing for us right now. So it's our opportunity to sow seeds into the kingdom. It's your opportunity to read with me our ULCC seed time. It is our prayer of protection and asking God's mighty blessings over our tithes and offerings. So I ask now if you would look on the screen and read with me. I profess this day unto the Lord God that I have come into the inheritance which the Lord swore to give me. I am in the land which you have provided for me, the kingdom of Almighty God. I was a sinner serving Satan. He was my God. But I called upon the name of Jesus, and you heard my cry and delivered me into the kingdom of your dear Son. Jesus, as my Lord and High Priest, I bring the first fruits of my income and my offerings to you, and I worship the Lord my God with it. I rejoice in all the good which you have given to me and my household. I have hearkened to the voice of the Lord my God and have done according to all that he has commanded me. Now look down from your holy habitation from heaven and bless me as you said in your word. I thank you, Father, in Jesus' name, and so it is. We have various ways that you can give this morning. You can do by Cash App, you can do by MoGive, you can do by text, or you can also submit a check and send it into the church. So however you give, we thank God and we ask right now that he blesses it in a mighty way, and that the amount that he allows you to keep, it will not be lost, it will not be stolen, and it will not be misused. So take those tithes and raise them up to the heavens, knowing as your praises go up, the blessings will surely come down. Thank you, God, in Jesus' name, and so it is.
Well, praise the Lord, praise the Lord. Thank you for tuning in with us today. I'm excited about this worship experience. I'm excited that God is still speaking, still working on us, still taking care of us, still thinking about us, and still present among us. So I want to take some time today to look at some things in the Word of God and just consider where we are in our personal lives and consider where we are as the body of Christ. This, it's always important to take that time to just stop, to just look, to just think, to just consider, and to allow God to show you who and where you really are. So grab your Bible right now and hold it up high, and let's make some affirmations together. Let's declare, this is my Bible. I am what it says I am. I have what it says I have. I can do what it says I can do. My heart is open, fertile, and ready to receive the incorruptible seed of the living God. And my life will be so much better after having heard the word of God. Amen. Amen. Praise the Lord. Thank you, God, for this opportunity for us to be together once again. I want to share a scripture with you. It's a very familiar passage of scripture. It's probably a lot of preachers' favorite scripture. And if you've ever attended a Baptist revival at some point, you're going to hear this passage of scripture. And if you have attended what they call a trial sermon, you may have heard this passage of scripture. So yes, you already know. I'm going to Ezekiel chapter 37, Ezekiel 37, and I want to look at the dry bones in the valley. Ezekiel 37. Read along with me on the screen. The hand of the Lord was on me, and he brought me out by the Spirit of the Lord and set me in the middle of a valley. It was full of bones. He led me back and forth among them, and I saw a great many bones on the floor of the valley, bones that were very dry. He asked me, "Son of man, can these bones live?" I said, "Sovereign Lord, you alone know." Then he said to me, "Prophesy to these bones and say to them, 'Dry bones, hear the word of the Lord.' This is what the sovereign Lord says to these bones. I will make breath enter you, and you will come to life. I will attach tendons to you and make flesh come upon you and cover you with skin. I will put breath in you, and you will come to life. Then you will know that I am the Lord." So I prophesied as I was commanded. And as I was prophesying, there was a noise, a rattling sound, and the bones came together, bone to bone. I looked, and tendons and flesh appeared on them, and skin covered them, but there was no breath in them. Then he said to me, "Prophesy to the breath. Prophesy, son of man, and say to it, 'This is what the sovereign Lord says: Come, breath from the four winds, and breathe into these slain, that they may live.'" So I prophesied as he commanded me, and breath entered them. They came to life and stood up on their feet, a vast army. Then he said to me, "Son of man, these bones are the people of Israel. They say our bones are dried up and our hope is gone. We are cut off. Therefore prophesy and say to them, 'This is what the sovereign Lord says: My people, I'm going to open your graves and bring you up from them. I will bring you back to the land of Israel. Then you, my people, will know that I am the Lord when I open your graves and bring you up from them. I will put my spirit in you, and you will live, and I will settle you in your own land. Then you will know that I, the Lord, have spoken, and I have done it, declares the Lord."
Amen. Amen. Oh, wow. What a powerful passage of scripture. The imagery there, the vision that God gave to Ezekiel is a powerful vision. And it's one that I think we need to really take into account today. When I think of this valley of bones, it reminds me of a song that I heard when I was a kid by Simon and Garfunkel. That song is called The Sound of Silence. And a few words of it goes like this. Hello, darkness, my old friend. I've come to talk to you again because a vision softly creeping left its seeds while I was sleeping. And the vision that was planted in my brain still remains within the sound of silence. In the restless dreams I walked along narrow streets of cobblestone, 'neath the halo of a street lamp, I turned my collar to the cold and damp. When my eyes were stabbed in the flash of neon light that split the night and touched the sound of silence. Those words come to life for me when I consider this valley of bones, this people scattered everywhere, body parts scattered everywhere. And I imagine the sound of the silence. In this passage of scripture, God takes Ezekiel into a look at what the people look like. He opens the eyes of his understanding and allows him to get a real concept of what the people look like. This is what Israel looks like. Now, keep in mind, this is a time when Israel has fallen into Babylonian hands, and they are in exile now. Jerusalem has fallen. They are in deep despair. They are hurting. They are devastated. They are fearful. They have lost hope. This is a horrible time for the people of Israel. And as we look at this vision, as we consider what God showed Ezekiel, I want you to keep in mind that although we're talking about bones and even bones that have dried up, we're not talking about dead people. We're not talking about the people who died in Babylon. We're not even talking about the people who died in exile. We're talking about people who are still living. But when God shows Ezekiel this vision, God wants Ezekiel to see dry bones. Now, keep that in mind. I need you to get that again, that we're not talking about dead people in this vision. So as he's telling Ezekiel, I want you to prophesy to these bones. And you all know the story. You read it in Sunday school. You heard it in church over and over again. And you know how God started prophesying. And then Ezekiel starts the prophesying. And we understand how the bones started connecting and all of this. That was awesome. And you would think that we're talking about dead people who are being resurrected. But that's not what's happening here. God wants Ezekiel to see how the people see themselves. I need you to understand what we're seeing here.
God is not showing Ezekiel a vision of dead people. God is showing Ezekiel a picture of living people who look dead to him. And watch this. He's showing people who see themselves as dead. And that's what really blows my mind, that in this vision, there are several things I want you to get here, but the first thing I want you to get is in this passage, God is showing Ezekiel how the people of Israel have come to see themselves. Oh, how horrible that is. And we know Israel had a tendency to do that. Remember when they were in the wilderness, at the time when they were ready to go over into Canaan and take the land. Remember, they sent spies in. And the spies came back. And the majority of the spies said, we don't want to try this. We don't even want to think about going in there because there are giants in there. And in that passage, in Numbers, the Bible clearly states that they saw themselves as grasshoppers. Now, come on. Israel had a way of seeing themselves as small, as wiped out, as just not enough, as insufficient. So here we are in a time they've gone through exile, but I mean, they're in the midst of exile, and you would say, well, okay, looks like you can understand them struggling some. Well, yeah, you can. But if Ezekiel is on the scene and he's the man who God can speak to, why isn't the same true for Israel? The Bible says that the way they saw themselves, verse 11, then he said to me, son of man, these bones are the people of Israel. They say our bones are dried up and our hope is gone. We are cut off. That's what they said. They said our hope is gone. That our bones are dried up and we are cut off. That's what they said. This God is telling Ezekiel, this is what they said about themselves. So I'm considering now, this is why I'm bringing this to you today. I'm considering now, we are in the midst of a pandemic. And this pandemic has really served to show us some things. This pandemic is revealing to us. We're getting a picture just like Ezekiel did in this vision God gave him. Through this pandemic, we are able to see now where everybody is. We're able to see who you are. We're able to see who is an Ezekiel and who are the dry bones. This is about identity. This entire pandemic event is about identity. It exposes us. It exposes who we are. So my question to you, are you the Ezekiel God can use? Or are you the bones that have dried up? So God allows them to see themselves. I mean, God allows Ezekiel to see how they see themselves. They see themselves as hopeless. There are some people before the pandemic who felt like they were hopeless. Some people were complaining before the pandemic. Some people were more focused on their issues than they were on deliverance before the pandemic. All this has done is exposed who we are. Are we
the prophet who God can use, or are we the bones in the valley? So that's the first thing I want you to get, that God showed Ezekiel how the people saw themselves. The second thing I want you to get is, remember, in this passage, Ezekiel starts to speak and the bones start connecting. And we get a sense that here the bones start connecting, and then the sinews start connecting, and you know, the tendons start connecting, and then you got flesh on the bones. And you can go through the progression of what happens to bring them back to life. But we can see that the bones come together first. And I want you to get this picture. I need you to really understand this, because what the Bible is showing to us, that you get the framework first. That if you have fallen in the state of where you are dry bones, or where if you're dealing with people who are in the state of being dry bones, that when we start doing the work that will bring them back to life, we have to understand that the framework is what comes first. But I need you to also understand that the framework does not mean that life is there. Many people have framework, but they're not functional. I got to say that again. Many people have the framework, but they're not functional. So when we see a vision of them, just as God has given Ezekiel of them, we would still see these bones. Still the bones. And I need you to understand that God would use this terminology relating to people who are alive. This is what gets me. You remember the woes in Matthew, the woes in Matthew 23. Powerful passage of scripture. You could read the whole scripture and find out how Jesus cautions us about these leaders, these religious leaders. And he says, in one verse of scripture, verse 27, he says, "Woe to you, teachers of the law and Pharisees, you hypocrites! You are like whitewashed tombs, which look beautiful on the outside, but are full of bones of the dead and everything unclean." Oh, that's a powerful picture that he gives us of these people who are walking around appearing to have it all together, appearing to be just it. But Jesus said, full of dead men's bones. In other words, God sees them the same as the vision he has given Ezekiel. So let me just unpack this quickly about the framework. Some people seem like they got it together. They got the job. They got a house. That's the framework. They might even have 2.5 kids. That's part of the framework. We just keep looking at the framework. You can have some things that are together. You can even be a church member. And that's all part of the framework. That's not the life. That's just the framework. But you can have all of the framework in place, just as when Ezekiel prophesied over these folks, but they're still dead. Y'all miss what I just said. Everything's all connected together, but they're still dead. Standing tall, but dead. Got it together. People even want to be like them, but dead. I need you to see this. I need you to see yourself. I need you to consider, where are you? Where are you in your life? Look around you. What is important to you? How are you seeing life? What's driving you? What's making you function? What's your purpose? If you don't know what your purpose is, you're talking about somebody who, any condition, can make you lose hope. God says about his own people, they look dead to me. He says they look dead. They're alive, but they look dead. And even though Ezekiel prophesies, and it works in terms of bringing things together and standing them up, but they're still dead. So the thing I want you to get from that is, a lot of us are walking around looking like we have life, but we actually have death. So this is a decision we have to make for ourselves. Do we want to live? Do we want to live? Do we want life? Or do we want to stay in the state we're in? Then I want you to get it that dead people, dry bones, cannot be talked out of that condition. I want you to understand why, when you talk to certain people, if they come to you with a problem and you try to work that out of them, you try to get it out of them, why a lot of times your words don't work. It won't work because you can't talk death out of folk. They need resurrection power. I've seen it in the counseling office. You can't counsel it out of folk. You can't reason it out of folk. It's not even something that you can lay hands on somebody and they get it. This is something, we got to understand the power of speaking. And this is what God is saying to Ezekiel now. Ezekiel's saying, I see a situation. He says, I see death, and I'm showing you the death that has overcome my people, the hopelessness, the despair that has overcome my people. And this is the spirit that the enemy wants to overtake the church in this time. But we have some options. We need the Ezekiels to stand up. And there are 10 things that had to be prophesied in order for life to come into the dry bones. There are 10 things that have to be prophesied, and these are the same things that have to be prophesied over your own situation, or on your children, or over your spouse, or over your friends, or even in the workplace. These are the words that have to be spoken when you see the condition of the people around you. And it's dead. It's hopeless. You ever seen somebody, you try to encourage them and can't? That's dead bones. Dry bones. You ever seen somebody that you gave them help and it didn't help? That means you're dealing with dry bones. You ever really tried to pray for somebody, and even that didn't help? Oh, but I'm coming to you today. Your words still matter, but you're not going to just pray them. You're going to prophesy them. Remember, the Bible teaches us that God is the one who calls those things that be not as though they were. And God is the one who says, my word will not return unto me void. And there are 10 things that God says to us, said to Ezekiel, and saying to us today that have to be prophesied. And here's the beauty of these 10 things. I need y'all to get this. Here's the beauty. I'm getting ready to close now. Here's the beauty of these 10 things. It doesn't matter how many numbers you hear in the news of the people who are infected. It doesn't matter the numbers you hear of the people who have died from COVID. It doesn't matter all of the other things that are going on in the earth. We have a responsibility to continue to speak the life that will cause dead folk to live again. In other words, we can never move away from resurrection power. We can never come into the mindset that is some alternative that will turn things around. Even if we get a vaccine for COVID, everybody's not going to get it. It's not going to work for everybody. And we are in a state now that only God can get us out of. And that's what God said to Ezekiel. He said, once I do this thing, once you speak it, and I make it come to pass, then it'll be said that I, the Lord, did it. It'll be said that I'm the one that made it happen. And maybe God is allowing COVID to stay along long enough for us to declare, but it's God who brought us out. And it's God who's going to make us live. It's God who's going to keep us alive. This scripture in Ezekiel 37 is not about dead people. It's about living people who see themselves as gone. It's over. It's done for us. There's nothing left for us. Some people are grieving coming to church like something died. Ain't nothing dead. We're still living. We're still alive. We're still functioning. We're still doing what God caused us to do, and more than anything else, we are still believing God, and that's what keeps resurrection power moving in your life. So 10 things. So when they start talking about how many people are infected, I need you to start talking 10 things. When they start talking about how many people died, I need you to start talking 10 things. When they start talking about how many businesses have closed, I want you to start talking these 10 things. When they start talking about the unemployment rates, I want you to start declaring these 10 things. First thing God says you need to declare is, I will cause breath to enter into you. I will lay sinews on you. I will cause flesh to come upon you. I will cover you with skin. I will put breath in you. I am going to open your graves. I am going to bring you up from your graves. I will bring you back to your land. I will put my spirit within you, and I will place you on your own soil. All of this is what God declares over his people. In other words, God doesn't give up hope, even though you might. So God just keeps speaking. I will bring breath to you. He keeps speaking. I will lay sinews on you. I will cause flesh to come upon you. I will cover you with skin. I will put breath in you. I am going to open your graves. I'm going to bring you up from your graves. I will bring you back to your land. I will put my spirit within you, and I will place you on your own soil. Come on. Listen to me. Listen to me. Because somebody has faced a dead situation. And you need that thing to live. It could be for your child. It could be for you. It could be for a parent. But you can speak and make it happen. Make things come to life for those who have given up. That's the commission God has given us. I'm an Ezekiel. It's my job to speak what God says when it looks like it ain't gonna happen. It's my job. I'm Ezekiel in COVID-19, but I was Ezekiel before COVID-19. And you are too. So I need you to start speaking, and have 3 things. I have 10 things. I want you to say these 10 things. If Barbara Franklin was here, she would declare what the number 10 means. But that if we go from 10 things to 3 things, and you will live. And you will live. And you will live. So I don't care how much you hear, the numbers you hear. We're overwhelmed by numbers. But I need you to speak those 10 things, and then I want you to speak those 3 things, and you will live, and you will live, and you will live. I want you to look around your house right now and just start saying it, and you will live. Say it in the atmosphere, and you will live. Keep saying it, and you will live. Declare it, and you will live. I tell you, get your wallet. Oh, you talking about some dry bones. For some people, that's the deadest place in their lives. Get your wallet. Get your car keys. Get the key to your house and start speaking, and you will live. And you will live. And you will live. Start speaking life in your circumstances. That's what God wants. God needs an Ezekiel. God needs you to be an Ezekiel. There are a whole lot of folk walking around here right now looking alive, but they're without hope. Some of the people who have hurt us the most, the problem with them, no life. Dead, dry bones. And that's why they're in the condition they're in. They don't see anything else. And when we encounter people who have problems we don't understand, many times we're looking at a situation that dried up long before we ever came on the scene. God needs us to be the Ezekiel to begin to speak. I say to you right now, if you're listening to me and you've not yet accepted Jesus Christ as your personal Savior, we speak over you right now. We speak over you, and you will live, and you will live, and you will live. But you must open your heart and accept Jesus Christ into your life. Or if you accepted the Lord at one time, but you know you've been off track, and you know you have allowed things to happen that have killed your dreams, that have killed your expectation, that killed your purpose, whatever. I need you to come back and accept the life that God wants to give. It's not enough that you got the frame to stand up. God wants to breathe on you, blow His breath on all of us, so that we walk and live in resurrection power. Paul said that I might know Him. Resurrection power. That's what He wants for us. So won't you accept that now? And let's pray now. Let's make these affirmations. Say, Father, we praise You and thank You for being our God. We thank You for the life that You've given to us. Thank You, Father, for wanting us and accepting us when we were in the worst conditions of our lives.
You are the God who calls dead things back to life. Thank you, Father, for Jesus Christ, who when we were dead in trespasses and sins, he died for us. Right now, because he has risen, we accept the resurrection power that is ours. And we walk in all of the inheritance of the people of God. In the name of Jesus, the living Christ. And you shall live. And you shall live. And you shall live. Praise God, praise God, praise God. Thank you so much for allowing us to worship with you once again. It's always a joy for us to come into your home and to spend this time with you on Sunday morning. We count it one of the most important hours of the week when we can come together, share the word together, and to be in the presence of the Lord together. Before we close, we want to also remind you that this is about to be voting season across the nation. Many states have already opened, and you need to check to be sure of when the opening is in your area. Everyone is being advised to vote early. So we are encouraging everyone to exercise your right to vote. But to ensure your vote is counted, you need to go early. If you're not going to the poll, then you need to be sure to get a mail-in ballot or an absentee ballot that you can either take into the polling precinct or you can mail it in. We want everyone to participate in this process. This is, I know, the most important election of my lifetime, and it probably is for the nation. So please make sure you take this seriously. Get out to vote and encourage everyone you know to participate in this process. And now we want to share the prayer for protection with you and the benediction and release you to enjoy the rest of your day. Come on, Morgan, let's share the prayer for protection.
Please repeat after me. The light of God surrounds us. The love of God enfolds us. The power of God protects us. The presence of God watches over us. Wherever we are physically, God is. Wherever we are emotionally, God is. Wherever we are spiritually, God is.
Lift those hands and receive the blessing of the Lord. In your day of trouble, may the Lord be with you. May the God of Jacob keep you from all harm. Send you aid from his sanctuary in Zion. Remember with pleasure the gifts you've given him, the sacrifices and the offerings. May he grant you your heart's desire and fulfill all your plans. May there be shouts of joy when we hear the news of your victory. Flags flying with praise to God for all he's done for you. And he promised to answer all your prayers. Amen. And so it is. And remember, you are the light of the world.
If you have prayed the prayer of faith today with Pastor, or if you are in need of prayer, we want to connect with you. We invite you to visit our website at ulccmacon.org. You may also leave a voicemail or an email, info@ulccmacon.org. We hope that you have been uplifted and enlightened through our worship celebration this morning, and we are confident that you will never be the same again. To know more about us, visit our website, ulccmacon.org. Thank you for worshiping with Universal Light Christian Center, the City of Light.